Welcome to my YouTube channel, The Madhuri's Angel. Good morning, guys. Welcome to my lexicography class. I hope you have enjoyed yourself well in the first semester break and already prepared yourselves for the study of the second semester of this year. A very warm welcome to every one of you. Today is the first time for me to address you in my online class, and I would like to begin with a brief introduction about me. Yeah, my name is Iqbal Nur Azhar. You can call me Mr. Azhar or Pak Iqbal. I am associate professor in English study program, Department of Social and Cultural Sciences, Faculty of Social and Cultural Sciences, University of Trunojoyo Madura. And then I'm going to be your mentor this semester. As you should know, our class is lexicography. Yeah, and the code of our class is SBE 348. This class is intended for the 6th semester students, and the status of our class is compulsory, which means all of you must have to take the class. Otherwise, you will not be able to get your Sarjana degree or Sarjana Sastra degree from our university. Lexicography SBE 348 is an introductory course in lexicography, and in one semester, you are expected to master a number of basic concepts and issues connected with the theory and practice of dictionary making. Now let's talk about the general descriptions of our class. The aims of this course are to make you understand the basic concepts of contemporary lexicography, lexicology, terminography and terminology, and then to become familiar with their basic concepts as well as with the semantics and morphology foundations that are relevant for understanding problems in lexicography field. The topics will cover lexicology, lexicography, the definitions of words, words formation, semantic analysis, analysis of the lexicons, semantic relations between words such as hypernymy, hyponymy, synonymy, antonymy, homonymy, polysemy, and others, and the structures of the mental lexicons, the micro and macro structures of dictionaries, different types of dictionaries, and many more. You are also you will be required to suggest a lexicographic design of a selected lexicographic project, and of course to conduct your own lexicographic practice. This is a very good chance for you guys to practice writing your own dictionary. In my basic course outline, you can see that it is stated that the course is designed to provide you with basic knowledge of lexicography and acquaint you with the short history of lexicography, the birth of lexicography as a separate discipline, and first dictionaries which have come down to our times, and many more topics. And then the course provides you with the information about different types of dictionaries and lexicographic principles of their compilations. Say for example, explanatory dictionaries, bilingual dictionaries, phraseological dictionaries, thesauri, encyclopedias, and many more. Separate topic of discussion will be history of English lexicography. Okay, by the way, the course will provide information to you about the history of creation of the first comprehensive English dictionary and lexicographic principles that are based on. That they are based on. You will be also familiarized. You understand what I mean? Familiarized with the best dictionaries of the English language, such as Oxford English Dictionary, Webster's Third New International Dictionaries, Cambridge Advanced Learners Dictionaries, and etc. Now, okay, let's move on. Let's talk about our learning outcomes. After taking this course, it is expected that the concepts mastered by you should increase your awareness of the range of current lexicographic works, yeah? And after joining this course, I also expect that all of you are able to understand the origins, the formations, and the changings of words' meanings. I do hope that you also understand some features of dictionaries and would be able to write your personal dictionary, which can be published in the future. Yeah, hopefully all of you can make it. You will meet with me 14 times in one semester. Okay, remember 14 times. And then I hope all of you will work hard so that you can get a maximum score from me. Hopefully we can cooperate, yeah, during this course, so that all of us, I mean you and I, at the same time will achieve our objectives. Yeah, I am as a lecturer, which achieve my objectives as a lecturer or the mentor of this course, and then you also will achieve your objectives as a student, yeah, of lexicography class. Now, let me tell you about our schedules, yeah, for one semester. Now, you can see my slides. So, in one semester, we will meet for 14 times, as I told you before. The first session would be, yeah. Okay, the first session is today, this meeting session. And then, actually, this session would be intended to... yeah, to tell you some informations, especially about the definitions of lexicography, the functions of lexicography, personal reasons to study lexicography, yeah, the development of lexicography, the principles of lexicography, lexicography outputs, linguistics area of lexicography, and other subparts of the big one, yeah, these big ones. Okay, the second session would be about terminography and lexicology. Yeah, of course, about the definitions of terminography, terminological relationships, terminological triangle, yeah, the characteristics of terminography, similarity between terminography and lexicography, and so on and so forth. Okay, you can check it in my slide. Okay, the third, it would be about what is etymology, early history of etymology, the origins of English words, foreign borrowings, semantic change. Okay, so you will have five subtopics there. And then the fourth meeting would be about English word formation. So this formation is about morphology, guys, yeah. Overview of English vocabulary and then types of word formations. Now, the fifth, yeah, or meeting number five would be about lexical relations, determining the meaning of each word in a language and how meanings of words are connected. The meeting number six, and then so we have six subtopics, this, yeah. Historical development of English dictionary. So what is dictionary? Historical development of I'm so sorry, there is a typo there. So I made a repetition. Yeah, I think number three, the third topic, can be erased. Yeah. Main criteria of dictionaries, types of English dictionaries, some examples of English dictionaries, and so on. Yeah. Meeting number seven. How a new word enters a dictionary. This is a very, actually, this is a little bit complicated, but I think. Though it is complicated, but it is very, very interesting. How does a word get into a Merriam-Webster dictionary? Actually, it's not about Merriam-Webster's only, but it's about dictionary in general. Maybe we would like to discuss some other examples of dictionaries so that you will be able, yeah, you will have broader horizons about dictionaries in common. Yeah. And then we would like to discuss also Google Trends. Yeah, I'm going to present to you website trends.google.com that can help you so much to find word trends, yeah, that can be picked up as your lemma of your dictionary. Meeting number 8, there would be midterm test, and then meeting number 9. So we have at least 9 subtopics. The internal structures of dictionary entries. So we have head word, orthography, pronunciations, grammar, definitions and translations, examples, usage, etymology. Okay. Hopefully, by attending this meeting, and then you understand the structures of a dictionary, so that you will be able to write down your own dictionary. Okay, the 10th meeting, writing definitions. Yeah, because this is the most important part of dictionary. If you cannot write your definition well, then your dictionary users will find a problems related to your dictionary. Maybe they will protest. Yeah, they will make a protest to you related to your competence in writing your dictionaries. And then also we have a monolingual dictionary entry. Yeah, who is the definition for? What is the definition for? Decoding functions and encoding functions. Traditional defining genus and differentia. So there are three. There are three models, or there are three methods that can be used in order to write definitions. The first one is traditional defining genus and differentia using synonyms, and the modern one, full sentence definition, so we call it as FSD. Yeah, later on I will show you what FSD is. Yeah, okay, writing examples would be for our 11th meeting. Yeah, functions of example, sources of examples, corpus examples, and cultural informations, and then what makes a good example. Okay. Meeting number 12. Some aids for lexicographers. I'm not mistaken. Okay. I'm planning to show you Leipzig. Yeah, Leipzig corpus, and then also Angkong software. Yeah, in order to help you to build or to establish your own database, Leipzig, Angkon, and WordCorp or DataCorp. Okay, later on we are going to discuss about them. Okay, meeting number 13, basic problems of dictionary compiling. So we would like to discuss some problems related to lexicographers that already work in this field, and then would like to discuss their problems. Hopefully by discussing their problems, you will be able to find out the solutions in case in the future you're going to have the same problems like them. Okay. So you have to understand that being lexicographers actually is not easy as you think, but also it is not as difficult as you think. It's in between easy and difficult. It depends on your strong will. Yeah. If you understand your problems, if you understand the obstacles that you will find in the future, and then it will make you a little bit easier to manage your time, to manage your activities in lexicography. Yeah, so we have some problems here: selection of lexical units, arrangements of entry, selections and arrangements of meanings, definitions of meanings, illustrative examples, and so on and so forth. Meeting number 14 would be individual activities, independent activities. So prepare your dictionaries and then consult your dictionaries to me. Yeah. Meeting number 15 also. It will be another independent study. Yeah. Preparing your dictionary. And then the last one, meeting number 16, there would be final test. Actually, this is not a test at all. This is only a submissions of your dictionary to me. Yeah. And then after that, later on, I will check your dictionaries whether it's very good or not, and then I will give you the score based on your final performance. I mean, your written performance of your dictionaries. Okay, now let's talk about the reference. There are 4 books you have to have. Yeah, you have to have. I do not know. Maybe you can download it. Sorry, download them in the internet, and then read them all. Yeah, remember, read them all. And then those the books that I want you to have and also to read. First one is written by Atkins, entitled The Oxford Guide for Practical Lexicography, published by Oxford University Press. And then second one is a book entitled Lexicology, A Short Introduction, yeah, published by London Continuum, and then it was written by Halliday and Yalop, yeah. And then Buer, 1983, the title of the book is English Word Formation, yeah, it was published by Cambridge University Press. And then the last one, Cruz, yeah, the title of the book is Lexical Semantic, it was also published by Cambridge University Press. Please guys, after this, try to find the books, yeah, in a library, or maybe you can go to the internet. I suggest you to browse Library Genesis, yeah, or LibGen. Yeah, I think you will be able to find them all there. Okay, why I want you to read them, because the books will guide you how to overcome your problems in lexicography. Yeah, I believe it. Okay, now this meeting. Guys, this meeting would also be intended to explain to you 7 subtopics about lexicography, as I told you before, in our timetable, yeah, in our schedules, yeah, meeting schedules. Okay, nah, so the topic would be about what is lexicography, functions of lexicography, and then development of lexicography, and so on and so forth. Okay, now. My question is, what is lexicography? Yeah, what is lexicography? Is it an English word, or yeah, is it it came from another word? I'm curious about this. What about you? Yeah. What about you guys? What do you think about lexicography? Is it an English word, or pure English word, or English people borrowed the word from another language, or maybe from other people? Yeah. Okay, you can see, yeah, in my slide. Actually, there is no information about that in my slide, but as far as I know, the word lexicography is of the Greek origin, which, if we translate it into English, means learning of words. Yeah, learning of words. Lexicography, meaning, yeah, means learning of words. Yeah, it's. Yeah, it is originated from Greek language. This study is a specialized study concerning with the compilation and editing of dictionaries. Yeah, this is a very special studies, yeah. Specific studies about how to compile and how to edit dictionaries. It is a professional activity and academic field, yeah, concerned with dictionaries and other reference books, yeah. Not only dictionaries, but maybe encyclopedia, thesaurus, and so on. In general, it has 2 basic divisions: lexicographic practice or dictionary makings, and lexicographic theory or dictionary research. So in lexicography, we have 2 parts. The first one is lexicographic practice or practical lexicography, and the second one is theoretical lexicography. Now, Cambridge Advanced Learners Dictionary, the 3rd edition, mentioned that lexicography is the activity or a job of writing dictionaries. It also refers to the skill, practice, or profession of writing dictionaries. Yeah, most parts of lexicography works deal with the editing or making a dictionary and the principles and practices of dictionary making. Okay, most parts of lexicography works deal with them, yeah, with two parts: editing or making, and yeah, principle and practices of dictionary making. Okay guys, in general lexicographers document the words of the vocabulary of the general language. But while in more specific area, the functions of lexicographers, it can be used as in teaching language, in teaching language guys, it proposes teaching language both native and foreign, It also has a legislative function, legislative function, especially in legislative function studies and problems of descriptions and so on. It can be used to normalize language. It relates with describing standardizing native language forming. It relates with describing standardizing native language, which forms a certain language norm. And then also it has another function which is called as communicative function, which deals with realizing intercultural communications. And then the last one, as far as I know, it has a scientific function. It fulfills studying vocabulary of a language periods of practical lexicography. Nah, some lexicographers may argue why they like lexicography. Maybe you yourself have your own reasons why you have to like lexicography. Okay, let me tell you the reasons, in general. First, it is because they love words. If you love words, then you like lexicography. By knowing lexicography, they believe that they can evaluate dictionary. Okay? Not only that, by studying and mastering lexicography, they become more sensitive to what dictionary have in them or don't. Or the dictionary do not have in them. If this happened to them, they can become a better user of dictionaries too. And sometimes they also believe that by studying lexicography, they will be able to learn, more about reference works in general, so that they will become a good dictionary editor or contributing editor someday, in the future. My question is, so what about you? Do you believe that lexicography will help you so much in your life? Okay, you do not need to answer that, but you have to stick in your objectives why you have to study lexicography, so that you will have positive spirit there in order to encourage you, to learn more and then also to read more books about lexicography. But if you ask me that question, the question that I already asked you, I will say like this one. Indeed, lexicography helped me so much in developing my competence as a linguistic lecturer, since I can use my lexicography competence as a background for vocabulary learning, teaching, and also for assessment. I can help. Another reason, I can help language learners with their language learning needs by using my knowledge in lexicography. Helpful, right? Helpful, and I will be very happy if I can help other people because of my competence. Okay, anybody learning the foreign language knows the value of a good dictionary. We all know how useful a bilingual dictionary can be in providing a quick translation for someone. Say for example, when we do not know a simple concrete word, a good well-organized monolingual dictionary can help a lot. Okay, this is the first advantage of having a dictionary. Now, let's begin by looking at meaning. You know that one word can have a range of different meanings. You know that, right? And then some of them are very similar to each other and some are completely different. The question is, which definition should you choose? So we have options, first definition, second definition, third definition. So which definition do you want to choose? If you have no competence in lexicography, and then I believe you will get a little bit, you will get problems in order to decide which one from the list. Okay, well, The first way in which a dictionary can help is by listing meanings so that the most common or frequent come first. Okay, which one is more popular, and then this definition will come first, and then which one is the least common or least popular, and then this definition will come the last. Okay, I mean like that, yeah. A good dictionary will also provide examples in the form of sentences for each of the different meanings. It can solve a lot of problems if you can see how a word is actually used in a sentence. Okay. The sentence should also help with understanding the way the word combined with other words in a sentence. Yeah, for example, a sentence in dictionary can also help you to understand how to use a word, yeah, in a particular context, yeah. Yeah, say for example, you cannot really use a verb, yeah, if you have a verb, and then you cannot really use that verb unless you know that it should be followed by a particular gerund or an infinitive, yeah, a particular infinitive, yeah, or maybe a particular clause, say for example that clause or whatever, yeah, whatever, it depends on the verb. Another important thing is the use of certain prepositional after some adjectives, which a dictionary will provide to you. Yeah, if you have adjectives, and then the dictionary will inform you what comes after the adjective. Yeah. Besides, dictionaries also give examples of common compounds and phrases which include the word you are looking up. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes also you will be able to find out phrases, a word joined with another word, yeah, a word combined with another word, maybe a word combined with another collections of words. You can say that, and it becomes a phrase. Okay, now the examples can give you a lot of information. I mean, the examples of dictionaries, yeah, the examples that you find in a dictionaries can give you a lot of information about the grammar of the word you are interested in. But it is not the only way in which a dictionary provides grammatical information. Yeah, a dictionary will indicate to what word class a word belongs. It will also has a system of abbreviations, symbols to tell you, for example, whether a noun is countable or whether a verb is transitive or intransitive, and so on. You won't be able to use a word correctly in a sentence unless you know the answers to such questions. Well, talking about English is famous, yeah, for its unpredictable spellings, and a dictionary is obviously going to be very useful there. Yeah, sometimes when you are not quite sure how to spell words in English, you can look up your dictionary. A dictionary will tell you whether the spelling is English or Americans. So there will be two options, whether it's Americans or it's English. Yeah, you can even find out whether a verb has irregular past tense or whether an adjective has irregular comparative form. Okay, you will be able to find those informations there in dictionaries. Now, the phonetic alphabet is used in dictionaries to tell you about the pronunciations of a word, and a special indication will help you get the stress in the right place. So, in dictionary, you will find the informations about how to pronounce words well, especially the way to put a stress. Because sometimes if you do not know how to put stress in correct place, the meaning will change, yeah, and then your interlocutor will not understand what you want to say. Okay, now let's talk about the development of lexicography. In the long perspective of human evolutionary, development of dictionaries have been known through only a slight fractions of language history. As far as practical lexicography is concerned, it has one and the same history that is divided into three periods. The first one is pre-dictionary period, second one is period of early dictionaries, the third one is period of developed lexicography, and okay, there is no more period lah, yeah, because there are only three periods. Okay, the history of dictionary making for the English language goes as far back as the Old English period, where its first traces are found in the form of glosses of religious books with interlinear translation from Latin. Yeah, it was the first, yeah. Regular bilingual English-Latin dictionaries were already in existence in around the 19th century. Okay, and then after that, the unilingual dictionary is a completely recent type, and then the first unilingual or maybe bilingual, or maybe actually this is not unilingual, monolingual, yeah. One language, a dictionary which consists information only in one language. Say for example English, or if you are Indonesians and Indonesians. Yeah. The first unilingual English dictionary explaining words by English equivalents appeared in 1604. Yeah, around 1604. It was meant to explain difficult words occurring in books, yeah. Big explanatory dictionaries were created in French and Italy before they appeared for the English language. And then don't forget also to mention Dr. Samuel Johnson's, yeah. He was a very famous dictionary, and then you can find the story of Johnson's in a movie entitled The Madman and the Professor. Oh, I'm mistaken, The Professor and the Madman. I do not know which one is the correct one, The Professor or Madman, or The Madman of the Professor. Try to find in Google. Yeah, I recommend this movie because this movie is very interesting and also inspiring, yeah, especially for lexicographer. Well, the purpose of Dr. Samuel Johnson's, the purpose of Dr. Samuel Johnson's famous dictionary published in around 1755 was to preserve the purity of the respective language. Johnson's dictionary was meant to establish the English language in its classical form, and then to preserve the language, in all its glory. And in conformity with the social order of this time, Johnson's attempted to fix and regulate English. So he would like to fix and also to regulate English so that no one at that time would make error English or irregular English. Yeah, Johnson wrote that every change, yeah, was undesirable, according to him. Yeah. Even a change for the best. When his work was accomplished, if I'm mistaken, he had to admit that he had been wrong. Yeah, no dictionary of a living tongue can ever be perfect. No English was perfect in that time, according to him. The most important innovations of Johnson's dictionary was the introduction of illustrations of the meanings of the words by examples from the best writers. By examples from novels, taken from novels. Yeah. Johnson, however, only mentioned the authors and never gave any specific references for his quotations. I think this is one of the weaknesses of Johnson's dictionaries, yeah. Because he never gave any specific references for his quotations. He didn't give any credits, yeah. Who created the examples? So that we do not know where the examples were taken. Pronunciation was not marked because Johnson was aware of the wide variety of the English pronunciations and thought it was impossible to set up a standard there. Yeah, he paid attention only to those aspects of vocabulary where he believed he could improve linguistic usage. Okay. The golden age of English lexicography began in the last quarter of the 19th century when the English Philological Society started work on compiling what is now what is known as the Oxford English Dictionary. Yeah. But was originally named before the Oxford English Dictionary, it was named as New English Dictionary on Historical Principles. It's a little bit longer, yeah. Okay, the purpose of this monumental work is to trace the development of English words from their form, yeah, their old form, in Old English, of course. And if they were not found in Old English, to show when they were introduced into the language, and also to show the development of each meaning and its historical relation to other meanings of the same word. Yeah. And the dictionary includes spellings, pronunciations, and detailed etymologies. Wow, there are so many informations about histories, yeah, historical phenomena, yeah, that lead to words to occur. The completions of the work required more than 75 years. Can you imagine that? In order to have the Oxford English Dictionary like we have today, it took around 75 years. A very, very long duration of time, guys, in order to have a canonical dictionary, yeah. Okay, now dictionary of course deals with vocabulary, but what I mean by vocabulary here is the total number of words in a language. Okay, you have to understand what I mean by vocabulary here is the total numbers, yeah, the whole numbers of words in a certain language. A person's vocabulary is all the words of a specific language known to him. If you are a lexicographer and then you'd like to write a dictionary of a certain language or a particular language, make sure that what you are going to write, I mean the vocabulary, are really from the language. Yeah. If you are going to write Indonesian's Madurese dictionary, make sure that what you write is Indonesian language, and also the translation, I mean for the target language, must be in a Madurese language. Don't take from another, maybe other sources of language, because it will make the readers confused with what you are actually doing. Yeah. A vocabulary is a set of familiar words within a person's language. Yeah, a vocabulary usually develop with age, and then the older you are, and then the more vocabulary you will have, and then they serve as a useful and fundamental tool for communications and of course acquiring language. So you will be able to acquire language if you have sufficient vocabulary. If you do not have sufficient vocabulary, you cannot get new knowledge, yeah, from books that you read. Yeah, acquiring an extensive vocabulary is one of the largest challenges in learning a second language. Okay, vocabulary may enter a dictionary in many forms. They can be in the form of jargons, archaic words, dialectal words, and then slangs and vulgars. When they enter a dictionary, they are called as, okay, you have to remember that, lemmas, yeah, lemmas. Whenever a vocabulary enters a dictionary, it is called as a lemma or a lexeme. Ya. Lexicography thus is a formal word for the activity or professions of writing and editing dictionaries. The inputs are, remember, unsystematized vocabulary, and they become, okay, let's talk about the output. Systematized vocabulary, okay, ordered by a certain pattern. Okay, you have to bear in your mind that the input of dictionary, lexicography work, are, okay, what I mean, the inputs, yeah, it's plural, yeah. The inputs are unsystematized vocabularies, and they become systematized vocabularies altered by certain patterns. Okay, now let's talk about the principles of lexicography. Lexicography comprises the recording of the word in the vocabulary of a language into a specific systematized format. Yeah, say for example, alphabetically by using alphabet formats, or maybe by using thematic formats or thematically. Lexicography has two basic principles. Yeah, the first is the theoretical principles, which consists of general principles of the applied science, and the theoretical principles that forms the basic for the general usage and expert principles. And the second principles is the practical principle which deals with the applied science of compilations and editing of dictionaries. So there are two kinds of principles. Yeah, the first one is theoretical principles. Second one is practical principles. The principle used in order to build, and also in order to build your theories, yeah, establish your theories. And the second one is in order to create something, I mean to create your dictionaries. Now, lexicography outputs. Lexicography is the process in which linguistic information is being recorded, processed, and compiled in a specific lexicographical unit. Actually not unit, but format, yeah, maybe, yeah, format. Now, the result of the lexicographical process is usually a word list, glossary, dictionary, thesaurus, or maybe electronic computerized data bank. Yeah, today we have so many data banks. Yeah, because, yeah, thanks to the internet, yeah, and thanks to so many IT vendors or maybe IT developers, so we have data banks of words, yeah. The information which are supplied by a dictionary are, okay, you can find spellings in a dictionary, pronunciations, definitions, or explanations. Definition explanation here is in semantics realm, yeah, in semantics circles. And then also we'll have syllabification, and then equal translation, and then derived forms and compounds, grammatical class, usage, I mean in syntax, yeah, cross-reference to other entries, illustrations, etymology, and then source reference, and etc. Okay, linguistic area of lexicography. Okay, remember, yeah, this will be the last part of our discussion today. Okay guys, let's talk about the last parts of my presentations. Yeah, it's about linguistics area of lexicography. Well, yeah, I believe that in order to master a lexicography, I mean in order to make you a good lexicographer, well, you have to be familiar with the following linguistic subjects. Yeah, try to be familiar with the list of some linguistic subjects here. Yeah, some informations about linguistics, yeah. First one is terminography. Try to understand the essence of terminography. Second one is lexicology. Try to understand what lexicology is, especially about the essence of words and then classification of words. Yeah. Try also to understand semantics, especially some parts of semantics such as sense relations, synonym, polysemy, antonymy, homonymy, and so on and so forth. And then morphology. Yeah, in formology, you will be able to find out some information about word formation, stem affixes, and etc. Try to understand them all. And then sociolinguistics, particularly about language variety, such as registers, jargon, slangs, dialects, sociolects, basilects, and so on. Okay, by understanding all terms that I already mentioned to you, I believe that your understandings will help you so much in order to carry out a certain lexicography project. Okay, good luck with your dictionary, good luck with your lexicography project, and then see you somewhere around, okay?